this is not supposed to be in any way, shape, or form a substitute to a plane. This is an experience that you go to try to travel in a different way. Benvenuto, Klatz. We are here in the Mediterranean Sea. The entire country of Italy is behind me currently. We have just sailed about 1,000 nautical miles from the country of Israel all the way to Italy. We are pulling in right now to the gap between Sicily and the mainland of Italy. And we are going to be talking to you guys today all about how to sail on a cargo ship, everything you need to know. This is going to be your ultimate guide on how to sail on a cargo ship. If you do want to get into detail about certain parts of this video, make sure that you check out my other videos because there's going to be tons of cargo ship content on this channel coming out. This is going to be the ultimate wrap up though. All the parts, everything you need to know. This is your brief rush course on everything you need to know on how to travel on a cargo ship. Also, I want to make sure that if you're new here, you do subscribe and turn on that notification button so you get notifications on my videos so you can keep watching them. Because we're going to have more cargo ship content coming out real soon. So I should mention this as a little opener. Traveling on a cargo ship is a little bit difficult. It is not the easiest process in the world to get onto on board. And it takes a little bit of searching, it takes a little bit of hassling, a little bit of nagging, a little bit of information that you need to know from online to get this done. But it is very much possible. To give you guys a little bit of my history on how I know how to travel on a cargo ship, first time I ever heard about this means of travel was in a hostel in Canada from a friend who had mentioned it to me. And then last summer I was actually crazy enough to try to pursue the idea, and I sailed all the way from La Spezia in Italy to Miami, Florida, stopping in about 5 countries along the way. It was an amazing 18-day journey through the Atlantic Ocean, absolutely beautiful. I got to visit so many new amazing places, and I'm so grateful that I did the journey. This journey that I did now is a little bit different, is a little bit shorter, and it only encompasses the Mediterranean Sea from Israel to Italy. But without further ado, let's get right into it. First things you gotta know, how do you actually physically book a cargo ship journey? All right, so we've had to move locations because it got super windy out of nowhere. Just take a gander at our beautiful view here by Italy. This is unfreaking believable, Klatz. So as I was saying, there are very few companies that can actually get you on a cargo port. I will be linking them down below, so make sure you check them out. One of them is Australian, one of them is from New Zealand, one of them is from England, from Germany. They have them from all over the world. The best thing that I have to tell you, this is what I did. I bought $10 of Skype credit on my Skype account, and I would dial these different accounts to see what their availability is. This is your best case scenario rather than emailing, because they take forever to get back to you on email. I would say contact these companies beforehand. Two specific ones that I would try to contact is Hamburg Süd, which is a Germany cargo ship company. It's called Freightersteig, something like that, and they actually are the ones that shipped me across from Italy to Miami. And the Grimaldi Group, if you're Italian, then you are hands down set. So I would just say try to contact other agencies like the cruise people in the UK or the German company that I spoke to. They are very nice and friendly, and they also speak English, and they'll help you out with booking the cargo ship journey. So that covers who you should contact to try to get this cargo ship journey going. This is your single only way, either via email or phone call, to try to get yourself some type of itinerary. They will usually email you after your phone call the itinerary for the thing with a price estimate. Wow, look at that yacht, holy. So that right about covers how you actually get in the process of beginning to book this. So next thing you'll need to know is, what are the actual requirements to be on board? Well, if you're 85 plus, most ships are not going to accept you, and if you're 12 age of under, most ships are not going to accept you. I would say this is not an appropriate trip to take with a family. The environment here is very much reliant on solitude and being able to entertain yourself for long periods of time. If you have kids running around, they're not going to enjoy it. There's no arcade and there's no game room. There's barely TV and videos. There's no internet whatsoever on most of these ships. And the ones that do have internet are very reliant on it, and it's very expensive to access it, and it's very slow. Very important note that we have to make right now, this is not supposed to be in any way, shape, or form a substitute to a plane. This is an experience that you go to try to travel in a different way. Planes get you from point A to point B with little to no enjoyment in them unless you're flying first class. This is something you have to be open to experiencing. Unless for medical reasons you are trying to take a cargo ship ride because you can't physically travel in a plane, do not under any circumstance use this as a form to get from point A to point B. It takes very long, the schedule is unpredictable, the time slots are very different, and the crew has you as their last resort to take care of, their last responsibility. Here you are seen as more of an inconvenience than you are seen as somebody to take care of. It's not like on a cruise ship where you are, your first demand is what's most important. Here, you just try to get out of people's way and try to do your own and try to just enjoy the experience of being on one of these ships. Next, we will get into money. How much money do you actually need for the cargo ship? You can look at anywhere between 70 to 150 euros for the cheapest rooms on most cargo ships. Some of the prices go way, way higher than that. I would say you should bring some spending money with you so you can use them when you get off at different ports. Every cargo ship is different, and obviously every port is different. In some ports you can't get off, in some ports you can get off. Some are more expensive than the others. So I would bring for no less than a 20-day journey, I would bring no less than 1,000 euros to have on you. And I would say euros are the best currency to have on you during your journey. Most cargo ship companies actually sell, in their actual cargo ships, they have little rooms where they'll sell you certain things. Kind of like a little onboard supermarket where you can buy just your basic necessities, and they usually only charge using euro. Let's talk now about safety on the cargo ship. Once again, like I mentioned, you are a last priority here when it comes to safety and watching out for your needs. But every cargo ship and crew is different. Some care a little bit more, some don't. It just depends who you fall on. But you have to try to get out of their way as much as possible because this is a working environment. It's essentially an office on the water. I would say don't come on this if you're an irresponsible person and you like to mess around and you like to have jokes and fun and try to do crazy stuff. This is not the place for it. You have to be responsible, cool-headed, relaxed. There's not going to be somebody watching for you constantly all the time. If you fall overboard, just as a situation, you have to try to figure that situation out by yourself, because most chances are not, nobody's gonna see you. There's usually only a few number of people actually working on the ship. On this ship, I think we only have about 22 or 24 crew members. So imagine falling off a ship the size of a parking lot. No one's really gonna be able to pay attention to it. But that's a very extreme example, and you don't have to worry about it. As well, with cargo ships, there's two main worries that most people have, which is the weather and pirates. Pirates are a small worry that you really only have to worry about off the coast of Somalia. Some parts of North and West Africa have experienced piracy, but it's really not that big of a deal. Most cargo ships can handle their own, and most captains and crew actually come with weapons to protect themselves just in case. As well, there's usually armies on standby to be able to take care of situations like this. Just to mention, it does happen, so you never know. It is always a risk you have to be willing to take when you're traveling on these cargo ships. As well, weathers. Today we actually experienced a pretty bad storm here on the ship, where the boat was swaying from side to side like crazy, and we had really bad weather and winds. This is something that comes along with being on the journey. These ships are built to last and built to go through these storms. And they actually have weather systems in the inside of the bridge to help protect you from storms like this and to help the ship actually navigate around them. But freak accidents happen and freak weather systems come into effect all the time. And so sometimes in the journey, you have to go through bad weather. I actually made a whole video on this and I highly recommend watching it because there's some tips in there for you to know about it. But I would say just bring some anti-nausea medicine, something that you know helps. Or if you're seasick, maybe avoid traveling on a cargo ship altogether. If you get seasickness or motion sickness, it might be a big issue for you because you are moving and shifting throughout the day a lot. Let's talk about accommodation next. Your accommodation can vary widely. There's certain rooms like super cargos and mini cargos, all kinds of different rooms and names on every different ship. And some ships can have between 2 to 4 guests, and some can have between 4 to 12 guests. So it just depends which ship you're actually on. The two ships that I've been on have varied greatly in accommodation. The ship that we're on right now cost just as much as the ship as I took last year, but last year's accommodation, I had almost 2 big rooms for myself, a giant queen bed, a shower. It was really beautiful accommodation, and it cost about the same as what we're paying now. And what we're paying now on this ship actually only has 2 bunk beds and a pretty old room with a mediocre to mini shower and almost no living space. So you just have to keep in mind the accommodation varies greatly between each ship. I would say contact the agent that you're booking this ship with and just ask him about the room that you'll be booking. You can look anywhere between 70 euros to 120 euros per night. But you should know that there's always a steward around that comes and cleans your room and actually cleans the garbage out. Let's talk about what's included with the price that you pay to get on this cargo ship. You actually get 3 meals a day, which are usually delicious. I have to mention, I have made a video on cargo ship food again. I'm sorry to be pitching you so many different videos, but we covered all these aspects. So make sure you check these out. All the links will either be in the description or coming up here on the screen. Food on the cargo ship also varies greatly, so it depends on what chef you get. In this specific ship, we got an Italian chef who has been making us delicious, amazing Italian food the entire journey. On the last ship, I also had a Filipino chef that made delicious Filipino dishes, and they were absolutely delicious. I enjoyed them so much. I have to say, on both cargo ship journeys I've been on so far, I have never been hungry. Every meal will usually fill you up. And just to get into the intricate details of it, you also get soaps with the room, towels, and access to the entire ship. Let's talk about packing, what you should bring with you. Also, another video that I already gone into detail with, so make sure you check it down below. But I would say this is the biggest tip. bring as much as you can. If you're traveling alone, if you're not planning on taking any more plane rides or backpacking after this, like I am, bring as much as you can. There's almost no limit. I think you're allowed 2 full suitcases per person on a cargo ship. You can store it all in a room and you never really have to worry about where it's going. So bring as much freaking stuff as you can to make yourself feel comfortable. Once again, the environment here is very desolate. So if you can even bring a TV in your suitcase and maybe a game console, you know, I would totally bring that. What we had on our journey here was a Nintendo Switch, and it added that extra bit of flavor to make you feel like you are at home and you're having fun. As well, you should bring some day packs with you, so when you go off exploring, some good shoes and a really positive attitude. Speaking of attitude, let's talk about the mindset that you should have when coming onto a cargo ship. Like I mentioned before, the cargo ship schedules can change like crazy. Even if you see it written down on paper, sometimes it can add different schedules, delays, and sometimes it can even make your trip a little bit earlier. I've actually luckily now experienced all of that. I've had my trip being delayed, I've had my trip been early, I've had my trip at different stops that weren't on the trip, so I feel like a very valid source to be able to give you guys this information. You have to get on the ship with a very easygoing mind that anything can change at any moment. And I talk weather, I talk food, I talk your clothes, your hopes and dreams. Everything that you're hoping for on this trip could change in a second. So you just have to be open to that. Basically, think about it like you're paying for an open-ended ticket that you might come early or later to any location in the specific route that you're on. That's the easiest way to try to kind of combat the craziness that might happen on board. Finally, I want to talk to you guys about the crew. The crew are going to basically be your housemates here on the ship. I would say come here and meet them, get to know them, and make them happy. They have a very hard and difficult working environment here, and a lot of them are away from their families for a very long period of time. So when you're here, try to make it a more positive environment rather than a more negative environment and be a burden on their soul. Try to be very happy and cheerful and friendly to the crew. I know that they will appreciate it personally, and try to make these connections because you never know, you might see them again around the world somewhere. Crew members that I've met on these cargo ships have been some of the most amazing people. They have really been truly deep and warm-hearted people that are here to like literally take care of your every need when you need it. And they have never ever made me feel like I'm not welcome. Even though technically they're not really supposed to pay that much attention to you, everyone I've met has been super, super friendly. So I would say when you come here, get to know the crew, try to bond with them a little bit, whether it be even the captains, the third mate, the chief mate, the engineers, all the way down to the stewards and the lower working people on the ship. To close this up, I want to talk about the ship itself. Every ship is different in size, weight, capacity, what they bring, what they don't bring, the crew that they have, the regions that they travel to, people that they have on board. I would say familiarize yourself a little bit with sea travel in general. The terms like starboard, port side, the bow, the stern, terms that people use on the sea and in sailing in general, just to give you that extra oomph so you understand what's going on when they come here. A lot of the times they give you emergency briefings and stuff, and they expect you to already know these terms, so it'll really help you out if you do a little bit of research on sea travel before you come. As well, bring yourself on here with a mindset to try to learn and experience as much as you can from these people and from this environment, because it will be a big, big learning curve when you live on this ship. And also, when you get your details and you get your tickets on exactly what vessel you'll be going on, make sure that you go the extra mile to maybe learn a little bit about the vessel itself and learn specifically what are the attributes that the vessel has, maybe what are the rooms that it has, what cargo it carries, maybe what it looks like. That way you can identify yourself with it a little bit more. These are just things that I wish I knew before I took my first and second journey, and I really, really think it's a smart thing for you to know. As well, an extra little tip that you guys should know, cargo ships are not like airplanes where a Boeing 747 is replicated for every company. Every cargo ship is unique within its own, which is one of the coolest aspects about traveling with them. So in addition to that, you can actually track every single one of these vessels around the world. And this helps you and your family actually know when your ship is gonna be on time, and your family know where your ship is when you don't have connection to speak to them. Whether it be your family, loved ones, or somebody who's just out there looking for you, you can actually send them where your ship is at all times. It's just a direct link. I will link down below the website to it. You can actually just search the name of the vessel once you have it, and you can track them at any time around the world. It is super up to date and super updated all the time. It is an awesome, awesome tool to have at sea. Another thing I wanna add on is getting yourself a cell phone with a good SIM card that has a global plan. That way you can tether internet from whatever countries you pass by. We weren't supposed to have internet throughout this entire journey, but we've literally been able to grab internet from Italy and from Greece and from Cyprus and just random islands that we're passing by, and we pretty much had internet the entire time. Part of the journey is disconnecting from the internet, but if you can get yourself that nice little speed here and there, just to update people or to have some type of connection, it could really, really help you out. Make sure that you bring things to keep yourself busy. I've also made guides on that. Don't forget that there's guides for literally almost every aspect of this type of travel on my channel, so you gotta check it out. And I'm gonna leave you with that, class. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. You shouldn't have any more questions after this, but if you do, feel more than welcome to leave them down in the description below. Leave your comments in the description below. Leave them in the comment section below, and I'll get back to them as soon as I can. Make sure they're subscribed with notifications turned on for some more awesome travel videos, because I make guides like this all the time in different locations around the world. And I will see you guys next time on our next adventure. I love you long time, class. A goodbye.